Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. For members of council, are there any disclosures of pecuniary interests this evening? Pecuniary. Wow, I got that mixed up. Pecuniary interest. I see none from no one. Okay. Move on to approval of council minutes. Looking for a mover and seconder for the public meeting proposed road closure held April 11th. Moved by Councillor Wilkinson, supported by Councillor Jacobs. Discussion on that motion. All in favor? And carried. And then looking for a mover and second for the minutes of the council meeting held April 18th. Councillor Hammond and the Deputy Mayor. Discussion on that motion. All in favor? And carried. Before we move on to the regular items of council, Mr. Neufeld, our CIO, has an introduction to make this evening.
Thank you, Your Worship. This evening, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Brent Ford. He's our new bylaw enforcement officer who has begun with us last week. Brent holds diplomas in both customs and immigration, as well as police foundations. And Brent comes to us with experience in dealing with and correcting site bylaw infractions, as well as property standard issues. And we look forward to his experience as we move forward with our town. Please welcome Brent. Yes. Thank you.
And I can tell you, there's several members of council that will be looking for great and wonderful things coming out of that department. No pressure. We did move all the minutes, so I should have asked this question first. Was there any business arising out of those minutes that we passed? No. Okay, so then we'll move on to public meetings and court of revision. This evening, we do have a court of revision, so I'll be turning the gavel over to the Deputy Mayor because she is the chair of that, and Councillor Dunn and I are not members, so we will not be speaking to any of the issues. So, Deputy Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, everyone. So we will start with the opening of the Court of Revision. I would need a motion to open the court. Mr. Wilkinson, seconded by Mr. Jacobs. All in favor? Carried. Are there any disclosures of pecuniary interest amongst our members? Nothing? Well, let's move on then to the items for consideration. And this evening, it is the first concession road drain east. Lindsay, did you want to speak to this then?
Okay, so tonight is the court of revision for the first concession road drain east for replacement bridge for Suzanne Thiessen. The meeting to consider was held on April 4th of this year, and since that time we did have an amended schedule of assessment prepared. That schedule has since been amended again. I'll turn it over to Gerard to explain those changes.
To you, Madam Chairman. With the help of municipal staff, we discovered that there were some transpositions in the assessment schedule with names relative to the areas and assessments that were done. So we did provide updated schedules that corrected all of those so that the areas and names and all jived correctly. For the Court of Revision meeting, we're recommending that they accept the 2016-04-20 version of the schedule as part of the final report. That schedule continues to set out the assessment of the works to the bridge owner served by the bridge access, and also to some of the upstream lands and roads that are affected with their flows passing through the culvert. The share to the owner's property would be 77%, and the balance of 23% has been allocated to each of the upstream parcels and the portion of the roadway that is upstream.
Great, thank you, Gerard. Is there anyone here in the public that would like to speak to this at all? No? Thank you. Is there anyone on council that has a question or a comment? Nothing? Well then, the recommendation is that construction schedule of assessment dated February 19th, 2016 and amended April 20th, 2016 for the construction of a replacement bridge over the first concession road drain east in part lot 15, concession 1, in the municipality of Leamington in the county of Essex, bylaw 21-16 be confirmed. All in favor? Carried. So then I would need, pardon? Oh, I needed them, but they all raised their hands. Sorry. Well then, gentlemen, I'll take Mr. Verbeke tonight. Thank you. And Mr. Jacobs? All in favor? Carried. Thank you. They all raised their hands, so I thought maybe I'd missed something. Anyway, then we need to close the court of revision, and for that I would need a motion again. Mr. Wilkinson, Mr. Hammond, all in favor? Carried. Thank you.
All right, so then we can move on to reports of staff and delegation. This evening, Mrs. Dresny is here again to speak to us in regard to the South Shore healthcare facility she's establishing. And we do have a recommendation prepared for us, but Roberta, did you want to address council again, or? Okay.
Thank you for having me again.
Sure.
Good evening, Your Worship. I've written a proposal over the last few days. The proposal came to my attention from the Town of Leamington. It's a Safer and Vital Communities grant. And Kevin O'Neill and I have done this work together, and he's written a strong letter of support. The police, however, can't apply for the grant. It has to be a grant that comes from various sectors. So my sector would be the mental health and addictions community health sector. The Erie St. Clair Clinic would be private business that owns the building and provides medical services to physicians through OHIP. And we need, those are two partners. We have a letter of support from the police, and we would like to have letters of support from the Town of Kingsville and the Town of Leamington. So this is a two-year project. It is a $70,000 grant over 2 years. It would really help to develop South Shore Health Center as a rural center of excellence. I'm not going to go through the grant at all. I'm just going to give you the title of the project and the four goals. So the project title is Developing and Sustaining a Rural Center of Excellence for Addictions Through Community Engagement. So to be eligible for this grant, there has to be a lot of multi-sectoral community engagement. And the project has four goals over 2 years. To establish a multi-sectoral addictions community advisory committee, to complete the first strategic plan for South Shore Health Center, and to implement at least four new local addiction services through various partnerships, and to develop and implement a community engagement and communication strategy for addictions for the defined service area. That's it.
Okay, thank you very much. Questions or comments from Council? Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Your Worship. I think it's a great idea, and I'd love to do it. The only question I have is, and I'll ask our CAO, in the past, when it came to, we called it proclamations or signs of support, let's say flying a flag out front, we've denied those requests. Is this along the same lines? Is it different? Can you explain that?
Peter?
No, this is not along the same lines. This is an organization that is making an application for funding. We have provided support when we are one of the community partners that is involved. So Roberta gave you a high level explanation. Let me see if I can bring it down a little bit more so that you can understand. The grant this year, the theme of this year's grant is called Creating a Safer Ontario Through Community Collaboration. All right. So what they're trying to do is create safer communities through evidence-based programs, enhancing partnerships between police, communities, corrections, mental health agencies, and other organizations. So as one of the municipalities, as a partner to this program, a partner in support of this program, it is different than just saying, giving a proclamation. We are actually part of the application process by providing a letter of support for her organization.
Okay. Deputy Mayor?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Roberta, we all gave you compliments last time you were here, and certainly well deserved. But I like the fact that you're also using all the resources that are out there, and for that, kudos to you, because I think many times people miss the boat on those types of things that are out there available to organizations. So good for you.
Okay, so the recommendation, if I can, it's just very short because we need to make sure the wording is correct. So that the CAO be authorized to prepare and sign a letter of support for South Shore Healthcare or Health Center to assist in obtaining grant funding. So moved by Councillor Jacobs, support by Deputy Mayor. Discussion on the motion. All in favor? And carried. Thanks very much. Peter?
Roberta, we'll have that ready for you very soon.
Next item of the agenda is a report regarding South Dales Drain and an updated assessment schedule. Take it away.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The recommendation of this report is that NJ Peralta Engineering be appointed to prepare a report for the South Dales Drain pursuant to Section 76 of the Drainage Act to prepare an updated assessment schedule. A request to do maintenance on the South Dales Drain was received in 2013. The current engineer's report is dated 1910. This report has a good plan and profile associated with it. However, there have been many severances since that time. So we have determined that a new assessment schedule is required in order to fairly bill this to our residents. This project was included in the 2016 budget and will be cost shared amongst all the landowners and roads in this watershed.
Okay, thank you very much. Questions? Councillor Verbeke.
Is there any chance we can see the 1910 document?
Absolutely.
Okay, I'd like to see that. I'll move the recommendation.
Wow. This could be quite the meeting. Okay, so we have a motion on the floor. Councillor Verbeke, supported by Councillor Dunn. Discussion on the motion. All in favor? And carried. Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda is one regarding the Labatt Mastronardi drain. Are you taking the same thing? Okay.
An engineer's report was prepared by Crozier Baird Engineers, and we're looking to adopt that tonight. The report is dated February 16, 2016, that was prepared for a change in assessment to the Labatt Mastronardi drain under Section 65 of the Drainage Act. In 2007, Newcastle Farms and West Point Greenhouses constructed greenhouses at addresses 400, 410, and 414 Mercia Road 3, as you can see on the map that is shown. At the time of their greenhouse development, it was a condition that they not take their water to the EJ Stockwell drain, since the drain couldn't handle the water. Instead, they had to take their water to be pumped into the Labatt Mastronardi drain. It is noted that the changes to the drainage has not been undertaken at this time. So the municipality is still holding securities from that 2007 development. The engineer that completed this report determined that the drainage area into the Labatt Mastronardi would change from 5.579 hectares to 26.66 hectares. Because we're changing the watershed boundary, the manager of engineering will advise the owner to redirect their water from the EJ Stockwell to the Labatt Mastronardi within 60 days of notification, and that the connection to the EJ Stockwell drain will be blocked at that time. This project will be assessed to the three addresses I previously listed, and there's no municipal cost for this project.
Thank you. Questions, comments? Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. So how much in securities do we hold back, try to ensure that this is done within a proper time frame?
I believe we have about $70,000 in securities at this time.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Your Worship. And along those lines, out of curiosity, when we hold money like that, which has been out for, what, 8-9 years, is that... Do we pay interest on that money, or do we, like...
We haven't in the past.
Well, I just out of curiosity. I didn't know. Like, I mean, I know that some of it is...
Ginny's saying no. So I know we've gone through this before, and the answer was no, we do not pay interest on it. So, okay. Councillor Verbeke?
For the mayor, thanks. In your professional opinion, going from 5 hectares to 26 and knowing where that drain's located, and I tap into that, do you believe that that is going to be big enough to withstand and support 26 hectares?
As part of the engineer's report, one of the things they do look into and verify is that the drain has capacity to handle that additional water.
Deputy Mayor?
I will just say I'm glad we're giving them 60 days to get the work done and that we will be checking into it.
Okay, if there are moved by Councillor Verbeke, support by Councillor Wilkinson. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? Carried. Before you go, Lindsay, can we really see, how far back do our drainage documents go? 1910 for the one. I know we're kind of making fun up here, but interesting.
They do go back to quite some time. Back in the past, there was a Ditches and Watercourse Act, so things have changed. We do have quite old documents, though.
And are they actual physical documents, or are they microfiche?
Yes, there are physical documents
cool.
We have.
All right, well, we'll have to...
You're more than welcome to come up and look at the documents
All right.
Anytime.
Well, we'll come bother you. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. The next item on the agenda is a technical review of the water supply to the Leamington Municipal Marina. Ronan? Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of Council. It's recommended that Council approve at this time a technical review of the water supply currently at the marina. And just for Council's understanding of where we're at with this report, the background: in September of 2014, late fall, just before the marina closed, the marina developed a significant water leak. This leak did not manifest itself anywhere on the property. We could not see where the leak was coming from. With the engineers and our current service provider and contractor for water services, through all their deductions and eliminations, it was decided that this break was coming from the south side of the facility, so to the dock serviced by A, B, and C, D. That's the first two docks closest to the break wall. Under their recommendation, due to the amount of water loss that we were experiencing, we decided to cap that line, simply because we could not find the leak, the source of the leak. It was not showing up anywhere. In 2015, we did decide to run an additional line along the gas docks, which was now servicing three piers. Of note, in 2011, when we rebuilt the marina, the current occupancy at the marina was 135 seasonal boats. When this leak occurred in 2014 and going into 2015, we had jumped some 42% in seasonal dockage. The 14 and 15 years were extremely cold, rainy, and wet, as you all will recall. This did not manifest and did not show up as far as our water use being a concern until the middle of that season. We identified that we had a loss in volume because now we were servicing three piers with one line. For 2016, we did budget to put in and look at separating the third pier off of the first two piers. So in essence, two would now be serviced rather than three. That did not increase our volumes. With further investigation and discussing it with our water authorities, it has been suggested now that our demand has basically outgrown our supply for our current occupants at the facility. This leaves us quite a significant shortage in water to three of the docks out of four. With our continued growth, it is recommended that it's this time that we ask for an engineering company to come in and do a technical survey of the docks to see what our supply should be and what we need.
Okay, thank you very much. Questions, Councillor Verbeke?
With the mayor, instead of a technical review, we know we're going to replace them. Why don't we just put it in? I mean, why don't we just, if it's half inch, why don't we go to three quarter inch right now? And because if they come back with a technical review, we're going to have to do it anyway, so that $10,000 go towards it.
Mr. Sharon? Or go, Mr. Sharon? Okay.
Thank you, Mayor Patterson. The reason that we're recommending to council that we go this route is because we want to make sure that it is designed appropriately. And it's been a long time, if ever, someone actually sat down and said, what is the demand? What is the water demand at the marina? And therefore, what size do the pipes need to be? And that's what we want to do. Given the number of piers, what's the size of the pipe, basically from the water main at the road, leading down into the dock area, and then how large do the pipes need to be feeding each dock, and how large should the water lines be that are running out into the piers, and what's the best way in which to service them. The challenge is if we use best estimates or best guesses, you know, we may do one of two things. We may oversize it, which means you wastefully put a bunch of money into the ground, putting in larger pipes, and if you undersize it, then you still have a problem. So $10,000 is probably a comfortable number. We can likely get the analysis done for less, but we are asking a professional engineering firm to take a look at the demands, design a system for us, and then let us know what they think that system will cost. So we feel that that was an appropriate amount to ask for that engagement.
Okay. Mr. Neufeld?
In support of all of that, we have to remember that we're looking at the waterfront as a future. So it may meet today's needs, but we are also looking at what's needed in the future. It's about the boats, but maybe it's about a fish cleaning station. It's about all the kinds of amenities that we want to have down there as we develop our waterfront land. So I think it's important for us to have have this consultation so that we know what it is that we need.
Is that good, Councillor Verbeke?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Councillor Jacobs next.
Thank you, Worship. I guess what you're saying, Peter, like, is this review to feed the docks, or are you looking at feeding the whole marina? That's my first question. Like, you're talking about a fish cleaning station.
Thank you, Councilor Jacobs. No, this service is for feeding the docks. In 2011, when we did have the rebuilding of the harbor and those three docks that were built in, we did consider anchorage, chain size, dock size for the next 20 or foreseeable years. Water at the time was based on the formula that our engineers give us for the current use, also looking at the future, but we did not anticipate the type of growth that we're seeing currently and the demand on the system with larger vessels, more vessels, more use on the system. And looking at it and surveying everything to date, we have found that the demand has just simply outgrown the line size on what we have there to service the boaters.
And I understand that, but I guess from looking at, you just installed like apparently a 2-inch line up to the marina office, right?
That was just to service the EF pier and take three piers down to two piers, so the demand, the system wasn't being supplied by three, it was being supplied by two.
I'm not an engineer, but I have to go along with what Councillor Verbeke is saying. Like, if you put a 2-inch water line out there, that's more than enough volume, I would think, to service. So all these people are doing with these boats are like, you're washing them and that's about it. Like, as far as the actual water usage, you're not watering lawns or anything, it's like a greenhouse, you know. So I would say take that $10,000 and just put 2-inch lines in and you're done with it. I don't know why we need an engineer to figure that one out, but that's my opinion.
Okay, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Your Worship. Now, Ronan, is there a possibility of the recent repairs that we just did to ENF, the 2-inch line that we did run, is there a possibility that's going to be null and not needed if they come in and they say, scrap that, what we just did? Is there a good chance that's going to happen?
That's correct. We did that in-house with our own resources and our own staffing.
All right. Remind me, how much did we allow for that in budget for that repair?
$5,000.
$5,000.
Deputy Mayor?
I just don't feel this is the time to nickel and dime a project. We're looking to expand the waterfront and do it up as nice and as fine as we possibly can. So why would we nickel and dime the water? they've tried it in-house and obviously didn't get the results they wanted. $10,000 is not an unreasonable amount to get someone who knows the ins and outs and the fine details of what needs to be done, rather than next year redoing it because we missed the boat, but we missed some fine points. I really believe this is money well spent. And as the CAO said, you're looking into the future. So I don't see the point in quibbling over $10,000 when it's something that we want to expand. The waterfront, the marina keeps growing, and we want it to go that way. So I'm all for it, and I would make the motion that we do this. I think it's only continuing in the way that we've already started on the waterfront from the dock over. Let's not just band-aid it or fix it in-house. We need to get a professional opinion. I mean, if it can be fixed in-house, yes, but at least we have the diagrams and the project outline from someone who is in the business of doing it and planning it.
Councillor Dunn.
Through you, Your Worship. My question is this.
Point of order, you have a motion on the floor.
Yeah, I'll second that. Second it, and then comment. Yep, question.
And then a comment. So with this engineer's report, are we also going to look at the lines that might be running down the docks too as well? The engineers will look at that. What materials and what best suited for all that kind of as well? Is that what we're...
That's correct.
So then, and I agree with the Deputy Mayor that let's let the engineers decide what's the best materials to use for down there and make sure that we get the right job done on it.
I've got Councillor Verbeke first.
For the Mayor, I've got no problem in a way. However, when a greenhouse operator wants to come in and put a 2-inch line in there, he's only allowed to put an inch line in. Now, I want to know why for 4 or 5 acres he gets only an inch line, and he's going to use the water, and he's going to spend the money, and he's going to do this, but yet we have no problem giving ourselves a 2-inch line.
I'm not sure I could make a comparison between the two, but Mr. Sharon, do you have an opinion on that?
Only Mayor Patterson to suggest that the two users are essentially apples and oranges. There's a reason we have rate of flow control valves and then we limit the amount of water coming in and the way in which our greenhouse operators use the water. It's basically to try and maximize the infrastructure that we have in the ground and spread that load demand over the longest time period that we can, a 24-hour day. This is different. This is a user. One of our challenges that we have with the marina is that, with all of our peers, there's how many, around 280-ish, around there, like individual taps to deal with. So, one of the things that we have to determine is, okay, at any given time, what's a reasonable number of taps that are going to be on? And then you sort of work your way from that load demand backwards to determine what size your systems should be. So, but specific to Councillor Verbeke, I would simply suggest that they're two very different users and we don't compare the methodologies.
Okay. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. Going back, to me, that you're just looking at the marina, we're not looking at the waterfront. We're in a specific location that we're looking at. And I think that, again, not being an engineer with this stuff, but I would think that we're looking, as you said, Rob, if everybody turned the tap on, you need a volume of water to come out of them. And to me, like, if you're just going to feed water down the pier, like with a 2-inch line, is going to do more than be sufficient. But that's in my humble opinion. However, I think we're going overboard spending that 10 grand for an engineer to tell us you got to put a larger piece of pipe, because I think we're using 1.25 inches now, Ronan, on the docks?
We have a 1 inch, and the three docks, CDEFTH, have 1.25 inches.
So that to me tells you that's where you're restricting your volume. I'm, again, not trying to be an engineer, however, I would think that the volume is the issue, that if, because your house is 3/4 inch, I would, on normal, so... My opinion, I'm not in favor of spending $10,000 to do an engineer's report that I think that could be done in-house.
Okay. No further questions, comments? I have no problem supporting this either. I know nothing about water lines, so I'm not afraid to say that. And if we can get professional opinions, and you're saying 10,000 was a comfortable amount, that you doubt very much you're going to spend that much on it, might as well get it done right, and look out 20 years into the future or beyond. So I'll be supporting the motion, just so everybody knows. It's anyway, I had another comment, but I'm going to let it slide for the time being. Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. Do we not have anyone in-house that can give us a guesstimate? I mean, really down to how many taps are going to be open at one time. That will determine. And isn't that really just a guess? And do we not have anybody in-house? I mean, we do have some engineers here that can give us some kind of an approximation. I understand both sides of the argument here, but I tend to agree with Councillor Jacobs in the fact that we could spend that $10,000 in upgrading a bigger line. I mean, if the volume's there, we can always, it isn't going to go away. So that's all I'm asking is, do we have someone in-house who could help us with these calculations?
Okay, Mr. Neufeld.
We have very capable staff in-house. I guess my question would be, which other project would you like them to set aside while they do this? See, this is the problem. We have an awful lot going on. We try to prioritize our work, and we try to find those things that we can farm out that, yes, maybe we could do it in-house, but it's one of the simpler projects that we can give out, allowing us to stay focused on our core competencies. And that's the issue here. Again, it's a, we have more work than we can complete in a reasonable time frame. The marina is one of our jewels. It sits in what we're hoping will be the tourist future for the municipality of Leamington. And just on Councillor Jacobs' comment, I don't mean to suggest that this water line is going to be servicing the rest of the waterfront. What I was getting at is we need to look out into the future. We need to do it right and do it right now as we build up the rest of the waterfront. Can we get the work done for less than 10,000? We hope so. But as far as bringing it in-house, it's just one of those things where we don't have the bandwidth to do every piece of work that needs to be done. And we wouldn't bring this to council to suggest this if we didn't believe this was the right step.
Okay. Councillor Verbeke.
Well, Mayor, thanks. Not to prolong this, what's the schedule here? I mean, why are we doing this now? Can it not wait till next year or till after the season? You know, some people just got their boats in. We're starting to fire this up. Why wasn't it done in March?
Ronan?
Thank you, Councillor Verbeke. We did look at the timelines right now are critical, which is why we're suggesting the survey be done imminently. We did look with our engineers and our in-house staffing as the best course of solutions in 2014 and 2015. We did try and put in different measures, again, hoping that they would work. They have failed us, so this is why we're going out for a technical review.
The review will be done this year, I assume, but whether the lines are replaced this year, are we looking at that?
We are hoping to replace them this year as soon as possible. Currently, just to put it in perspective, the first set of docks, AB, is completely sold out. The second set of docks has 6 remaining docks on it. There's 88 berths on each. The third pier is 3/4 sold out. So our current occupancy is 240 out of 290 docks. On the first set of docks, if you do turn on 12 taps open full bore, the 13th boat will have a trickle of water coming out, just to put it in perspective.
Well, I think it's very unfortunate you're giving us good news about how full our docks are, so bravo. So,
thank you, anyway, Mr. Mayor.
Any further questions on this? Because the recommendation is there for us, that we approve the technical review and that repairs recommended be brought back to council. What are council's wishes? Did we have the motion already? I'm sorry. And Councillor Dunn, that's right. All right. No further questions. Then all in favor of the motion? Opposed? And carried. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is an application regarding site plan control approval, proposed greenhouse expansion. Tracy?
Yes, I'll take care of that report. Thank you, Mayor and members of council. This report is recommending that a site plan be proposed for a greenhouse expansion for phase 2A located at 420 Essex Road 14, It's also known as Vine Fresh Acres Limited, and that the mayor and clerk be authorized to execute the site plan agreement. Just to give you a little background, staff have received this application as part of the phase 2A, which is a 4.5-acre greenhouse, an expansion of an existing service building, and a hot water storage tank. This is in addition to an existing development. There's already a site plan control agreement that was approved in 2014 for phase 1, which included a 12.6-acre greenhouse development as well as a service building. The municipality is already holding sufficient securities to ensure the completion of this work could be included for this approval of 2A is only for the additional phases, which would require further review and approval if any further additions came in the future. So there is no financial impact, and I believe the property owner is here in case you have any questions for us.
Okay, questions, comments from council? Moved by Councillor Verbeke, supported by Councillor Dunn. Discussion, all in favor? And carried. Next item on the agenda is a report regarding the Leamington Water System Improvements Tender Awards. Shannon.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of Council, the purpose of this report is to recommend awarding the contract for Morgan, Georgia and Chestnut Street Water Main Replacement to Nevin Construction, and also to retain the services of NJ Peralta for contract administration and on-site services. The Morgan, Georgia and Chestnut Street project is approved in the 2016 Water Division capital budget, and it includes replacing old cast water mains that have been beyond their useful life. The project will also include resurfacing Georgia Avenue, which is also approved in the 2016 engineering budget. There is a map that shows the area for the water main replacement work there on the screen. So we provided a summary of the tenders. Peralta has reviewed and confirmed the accuracy of all of them. There was one error that did not impact the tender order, and they have recommended that the contract for the project be awarded to Nevin in the amount of $569,925, excluding HST. Nevin has worked for the municipality in the past and has performed well on previous projects. So funding for the water main replacement and the Georgia resurfacing, like I said, will come out of the water and engineering capital budgets. I provided a summary of the project breakdown in the table. The contract also includes a $50,000 contingency, which we divided between the two budgets according to the portion of the contract value between the two departments. And assuming all contingency is used, there will still be a surplus in both of the water and engineering capital budgets at the end of the project. That's it. Thanks. Okay,
thank you very much. Questions? Moved by Councillor Jacobs, support by Councillor Wilkinson. Okay, so a question from Councillor Jacobs and then Wilkinson.
Thank you, Worship. Shannon, will we be experiencing when they start this work with some of the issues we had on Baird Avenue before, like with rusty water and all this other kind of stuff? Or is there any way we can have any precautions to that, or do you anticipate anything like that happening?
I don't anticipate that anything like that would happen. They will do their proper flushing techniques during the project. If there is, then we would address those issues as they come up. I'm not aware of the Baird just because of the history here, but I definitely know that there will be flushing as part of the project, so hopefully that will not be a concern.
You know, I guess where my concern is if once you start messing with some pipes attached to other older pipes, that they dislodge all this rust and everything, and I know we had quite an issue in the past with that, and I was just wondering how we can, or if there's anything we can do to prevent that.
And actually, historically, with the other area that we were talking about, Churchill and Baird, they were already having rust in their water before we even touched the pipe. And that's what really promoted the municipality to get moving a lot quicker on it. And actually, I thought we had already replaced all our cast iron pipes, apparently not. In this case, I mean, I grew up on Georgia, and I don't remember any rust being there. Are we having issues now? No, it's just our regular scheduled maintenance to move ahead on this.
Yeah, this is just part of the planned project improvements for the cast mains. We haven't had any complaints or issues in this area at this point, so I wouldn't expect there would be anything ongoing throughout the project.
Okay, Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you. Shannon, there was no time frame noted for this. When do you expect construction to start?
They are ready to go, so we're hoping with approval tonight from council that we can have the pre-construction meeting next week and get started within a couple of weeks.
Okay. And to the south of this, the pipes that are on, let's say, Lauren, I think it is, are they cast as well?
I'm honestly not 100% sure on that answer. I can check into that. I don't know if Rob knows for sure.
No. Yeah. Yeah. Plastic. Who knows? I mean, we've got not just the cast iron, a little bit of cast iron to go, and then we have that asbestos cement mixture, right, of pipes to, hey, was safe back in the day. So we're getting there. It's a huge project to replace all these lines. So anyway, we do have a motion on the floor. Any further discussion? All in favor? And carried. Next item is a report regarding the lower and upper screw pump. And I assume, Shannon, you're taking me through this exciting debate.
Yes, and I will try not to say lower and upper and bearing and screw pump too much throughout my discussion. But I may have to. So this report is to recommend that the PCC capital project for the bearing replacement on the lower and upper screws be issued to Spans Babcock. As part of the project, three lower bearings on the upper screw pumps and three upper bearings on the lower screw pumps will be replaced. That's all I'm going to say. Sorry. In addition, we're also requesting that one reassembled upper bearing be installed concurrently with this project. Just to give a little bit of background, three of the screw pumps in each station, were manufactured by Spans Babcock and installed in 2001 with the new headworks facility. And we recently installed the fourth screw pumps with a recent capital project in 2015. The bearings for these pumps are expected to have a life of approximately 10 years. I'm going to say it again. The six bearings to be replaced as part of this works, as well as the six screw pumps, were all manufactured by Spans Babcock. They are definitely familiar with the PCC based on their previous project involvement at the plant and are well known in the wastewater industry. The new bearings are expected to have a life of over 100,000 hours. Following this installation, there will only be one additional upper bearing that will require replacement in the future. Administration requested a quotation for the replacement and installation from Spans based on the information provided. And the request to single source the capital project has been reviewed with the CAO, who has authorized a variation from the purchasing policy for this project. The manufacturer has indicated that there will be a cost savings of about $8,000 to completing both projects concurrently. The project is to be funded from the PCC capital budget. There are two separate line items for this project identified and approved in the budget, and I've summarized those for you in the table. Originally, we had budgeted about $160,000 for both projects, and we are going to come in quite below that number. There will be some additional costs, including disposal of the old bearings, some rental equipment and cleaning that will have to be done to work up to do the actual replacement, but we are still expecting that those numbers will come in below budget. So based on the quotations provided and the additional costs, like I said, we're expected to come in below budget, and I believe that covers everything. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. On the bid process, the CAO says that you want to bypass it. Is there a reason, and can we theoretically do that?
Yes, we can. But Mr. Neufeld? Oh, Shannon?
One of the reasons with, like I said before, three of the screw pumps in each of the stations, so a total of six, were installed with the original headworks facility, and they were manufactured and installed by Spans Babcock. When we did the fourth installation, they decided to go out for tender, and it was a different screw, and it was installed by a contractor at that point. Jason is here to, I guess, allude to the fact that there are still issues with that fourth screw pump. So we have run into, you know, difficulties with getting them up and running. The Landistry, who we used, is actually overseas, so getting them here to service the pumps and help us, you know, work with some troubleshooting issues has been a problem. So we would prefer, and we expected to see this question from you tonight. So if we were to go to tender, we would still want to have the original manufacturer involved at some point, just to have them oversee the activities and make sure that everything's happening to our liking and make sure that they're operating, because those screws are ultimately what we need to be bringing the wastewater into the facility. So that's one of the reasons that we want to go with them directly.
Okay, that makes all the sense in the world to me then, so thank you.
Okay. Moved by Councillor Hammond, supported by Councillor Dunn. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? Carried. Next item on the agenda is a report regarding Leamington PCC energy study. And Shannon?
Yes. Okay, so this report is to recommend that the mayor and clerk be authorized to enter into the necessary agreements for an energy study at the PCC. As you can imagine, the operation of the plant does consume a lot of electricity, and our budget for the 2016 year is about $600,000. Despite decreasing some of our usage, the electricity costs continue to rise, so any effort that we can see and put forward to try and decrease those costs is beneficial to us. There is a Save on Energy grant program that's offered by the Independent Electricity System Operator, and that grant program is for process and systems. The program has two types of funding. The first grant would be for the detailed engineering study, and the second grant would cover a portion of the capital costs if we were to decide to move forward with any of the recommendations from that study. The municipality was recently approved for 100% funding of the detailed engineering study. The study is going to look at energy and cost savings from various operations at the plant, including pump and blower efficiencies, chemical addition, dissolved oxygen profiling, and UV disinfection. The report will provide administration with a listing of proposed capital projects that will be prioritized by cost, impacts on our operations, payback periods, timeline, and also availability of additional grants. I will note that approval for the funding does not hold us to do any of the capital improvement projects. That will be something that's considered once they are reviewed by us. The cost of the study is $50,000 and will be performed by Environmental and Power Solutions of Waterloo, Ontario. They have extensive experience in the energy sector and have led the completion of numerous detailed engineering studies for other wastewater treatment plants in Ontario. Essex Power Lines has approved 100% reimbursement of these costs. So once the final report is received and we are happy with that report, we will pay Environmental Power Solutions for their work. And then once we show the LDC that we have paid that $50,000, they will then reimburse us for that funding. This project and the expense and the reimbursement weren't originally included in the 2016 budget, just given the timing of the grant approvals. But at the end of the day, there will be no impact to the budget because there will be a reimbursement once we pay those funds out. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Questions, comments? Councillor Hammond.
Yep, thank you. Shannon, this is a great report. Shannon and I had a brief discussion about the cost of the use of electricity or hydro there at the plant. And $600,000 a year for operating is a lot of money. So anytime we can look at trying to reduce that operating cost is great. And I think it really should be emphasized again, especially in fact that we're going to get 100% reimbursement of that $50,000 it costs us for that study.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Good. Then I'm looking for a mover and seconder. Councillor Hammond, Councillor Dunn. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? Carried. Next report is one regarding the pump station communication, and Shannon is taking us through again.
This is what happens when I have 2 weeks to write reports. Okay, so this report is to recommend communication upgrades for our pump stations, which is to be managed through Onyx Engineering and charged to the PCC reserve account. And the other recommendation associated with this report tonight is to authorize administration to provide a letter of endorsement and a copy of a press release for the smart remote technology that will be employed as part of the project. Just a little bit of background. The PCC is currently serviced by 13 pump stations. With the Peely Bevel project that is currently being planned, there will be an additional 4 stations coming online. 11 of the existing stations either have Bell or Allstream communication, and they communicate back to the PCC through our SCADA system and also through Security One. Of those 11 stations, 8 of them have data acquisition capabilities, which means we can monitor flow and pump start and stop times. The remaining 2 stations currently have no communications at all. The lack of communication between the remaining stations is troublesome for us. We need to establish some communication so that we can monitor those stations regularly. And administration has also experienced delayed response times from Bell and Allstream when we've had issues with communications. At times, it's taken them multiple days to restore those communications, which means that our pump station operators and wastewater treatment plant operators have to physically go to the pump stations multiple times a day to make sure that there's no pump failure, which could result in flooding and power outages and as such. So administration had originally carried funds in our 2016 budget to begin upgrading pump stations with an initial plan to upgrade 1 to 3 stations each year and bring them on the cellular system. Administration has met with Onyx, and when we had that meeting, they had brought forward an opportunity to complete the upgrades as part of a pilot study. The pilot project would allow the municipality to upgrade all of our stations for remote data acquisition across the cellular network concurrently, which would improve pump station monitoring capabilities and provide us better communications and data trending abilities. The smart remote monitoring technology for the study would be provided by Multitech Systems Inc., which is a US-based company. They have extensive experience in the communications industry and are offering us a savings of 50% for the pilot project in return of a letter of endorsement and press release on this system that is installed for us. The issuance of the letter of endorsement and the press release will be contingent on the pump station communications operating successfully, and that would be over a period of 3 to 6 months that we'd be able to monitor that. Moving towards the cellular network, communication will provide us with improved customer service, response time in the event of an equipment failure, as well as a cost savings on the monthly data service fees. Getting into the finances, the project is going to cost us $25,000 and will be performed by Onyx Engineering. Onyx will be partnering with M2M, which stands for machine-to-machine communications, and Multitech Systems for the hardware and cellular data packages. Once again, this request is single source. This project has been reviewed with Peter, who has authorized a variation from the policy. If the municipality were to choose to forego the pilot study at this time and proceed with upgrading 1 to 3 stations a year, we would be looking at a cost of over $40,000 over the next 4 to 5 years. In addition to the $18,000 savings for the hardware and installation costs, there's also going to be an additional savings for the monthly service fees. Currently, we pay approximately $6,000 a year for Bell and Allstream, and moving towards the cellular network, we'd only be paying about $10 per month per station, which would be under $2,000 a year. So that would be an additional $4,400 in savings each year. Considering just that communication cost savings, we're looking at a return on an investment of about 5 years. The pump station upgrades were not initially planned to occur in the same calendar year, and therefore they have not been included in the 2016 budget. Administration is therefore proposing to fund the project using our capital reserves account for PCC. There is an account balance of just under $6 million projected for the end of 2016. Utilizing the $25,000 from that reserve account will not have a significant impact on the balance and will still allow for future funding from that account. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. A great initiative to go for something like this and save a pile of money. My question, though, is will this be able to be connected to your smartphone, let's say to your BlackBerry, whatever, if you have an issue going on in the plant, it will alert you whether you're there or not type thing? I know you have someone there all the time, but so that everyone that needs to be notified can be immediately on something like that?
We haven't looked into doing that, but what I can say is that it will communicate back to the plant SCADA system as well as Security One. The plant isn't actually manned 24 hours a day, so the alarms would go through Security One, and then they would contact our operators. The potential to add it to a cell system or an iPad system is something that we are looking into, but that would be something that we could do in-house as part of a remote station, similar to what we have on our water vehicles. And we have a remote Wi-Fi access through those vehicles. So we're looking at doing that for our PCC trucks as well. So would it allow that communication?
Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Your Worship. Shannon, yes, I think this is a fantastic thing. I'm fascinated by these pump stations ever since I got on council and Luann took me around to all of them. And when I walked away from that, I realized how much we rely on the pump station operators who spend a lot of time there. In your, what's the scope on what can be offered through having this monitoring system? Like, will you be able to know when the pump needs to be turned on and you could fire it from the plants, lessening our reliance on the pump station operators? And is that included in your savings, the $43,000 that you're talking about here?
If I can, what Tim's talking about are drainage pumps. Is what you're talking about. We're talking about sewage pumps, which we have that you probably haven't seen. I don't think I've ever seen them. I don't think I want to see them. But maybe you can answer the questions applicable to the pumps that we are talking about then.
Yeah, so one of the things that we were talking about in terms of the remote station and being able to have the iPad there as well, we probably won't have the communication set up right now to be able to turn pumps on and off, but the data acquisition part of it in terms of seeing when the pump starts, when the pump stops, the flows that are going through that pump, if there's an alarm. Right now we rely on Security One to call us. These are things that we would be able to see remotely on our SCADA PCC, at the PCC, sorry.
So just to further, no, I know it's yeah, yeah. But when the pumping stations go down in our sewer system, that then causes issues for roads and basements and so on and so forth. So this is where it's going to pay big dividends in that respect. Deputy Mayor, question you.
No, I was just going to say that it's basically a no-brainer if you can get them to pay for half of it and then the monthly bills cost you less than that, that's even better. Plus, if you've got a service that doesn't give you service, you might as well kick them to the curb. So what a wonderful opportunity, and we have money in the bank.
Yeah.
So with that, I would make the motion.
Good. Second by Councillor Dunn. And just my comments too is that taking the money out of the reserves, I don't have a problem with because it's a small amount, and creating efficiencies like this where we don't have our manpower wasting their time driving out to the pump station. That's what we're trying to do in every area of our operation here in the municipality. So good move. Further discussion, questions on that? All in favor of the motion then? And carried. And so sad, Shannon, that's your last report tonight. Next item up is a tender report, results on Shirk Street resurfacing. Alan?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The report before you is to award the 2016 asphalt paving program to the Milam Corporation. This year, majority of the program is going to go toward the repaving of Shirk Street from Seacliff Drive all the way to Oak Street. And part of the project is also replacing some of the curbing approximately from Seacliff Drive to about Audrey Street. It's about 400 or 500 meters of the curbing. And we did tender it. We did get two submissions, one from Milam, one from Coco. And our low bid is from the Milam Corporation, and it's just about bang on our estimate. And we are recommending that we award the contract to Milam.
Questions? Councillor Verbeke?
For the mayor, thanks. This is just for the resurfacing. We're not talking street lights aren't going up on Shirk and County Road 20.
You mean stoplights?
Yeah, what did I say? Search lights?
Street lights. He means the traffic signals.
Certainly. This contract is just for, or majority is the paving. We are replacing some curbing. The traffic signal is close to being tendered. That work will be done this year as well.
So we have a recommendation before us. What are councils? Moved by Councillor Verbeke, support by Councillor Jacobs. Discussion on the motion. All in favor? Carried. Next report is one regarding the appointment of Treasurer and Deputy Treasurer, Mr. Neufeld.
Yes, thank you. On April 26th, the Director of Finance and Business Services tendered her resignation. In addition to her role as the director, she was also appointed as the treasurer of the municipality, which is a statutory requirement that there be a treasurer. Immediately thereafter, in consultation between myself with Dave DelCiancio and Ginny Campbell and Katie McLean from the Finance Department and IT, it was determined that the management role would be the director's role would be assumed by Dave DelCiancio, and the technical role would be taken on by Ginny as our acting treasurer. And the three of them had gone away and discussed how we could best move forward in the interim. And I think that the solution that they came up with is very good. It speaks to their technical specialties. And Dave is taking on the management role. So Dave, I have appointed Dave as the acting director, but in addition to being the director, we'd like Ginny to be council to appoint Ginny as the acting treasurer for the municipality, and then add Dave as the acting deputy treasurer, which will allow for enough signing authorities for carrying on banking and signing checks and that sort of thing. That will give us five, which is what we normally have. Two people are required to sign any of the documents. So just to reiterate that Dave has been appointed the director. Tonight we're recommending that council appoint Ginny as the acting treasurer and also appoint David as deputy treasurer.
Questions, comments? Moved by Councillor Verbeke, supported by Councillor Hammond. Discussion on the motion. All in favor? Carried. Good luck to the two of you. Matters for approval. We have the minutes of the Leamington Municipal Heritage Advisory Committee. Looking for a mover and seconder. Deputy Mayor and Councillor Dunn. Discussion on the motion. Councillor Verbeke.
Item two here. I'm just kind of curious with the Gregory Building. Is there anything going on with that, or are you allowed to say yet?
I'm not allowed to say because I haven't been told everything yet. But Mr. Sharon?
Thank you, Mayor Patterson. To provide council an update on the Gregory Building, the municipality did put out an RFP, and we looked for individuals who were interested to assume ownership of the Gregory Building and invest in the facility and lead to uptown revitalization. We did receive submissions on that RFP process. A review committee did meet on two occasions and worked through and selected the preferred proponent. Right now we are in the process of finalizing the terms and conditions of the agreement that we will recommend that council enters into. That's going to take a number of weeks in order to put all those terms and conditions and get the legal agreement and make sure everybody's on the same page. And when that's ready, we'll bring it forth to council, and it is at that time that we'll disclose who we're recommending that council enter into the agreement with.
Okay. Very good. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion? Carried. I need the clerk to report on a closed session. I didn't have any that I'm aware of.
A closed meeting was held at 5:45 prior to the open session of council pursuant to subsection 239(2)(c) for the purpose of considering confidential reports LLS 1716 and LLS 1916 regarding purchase of lands. Proper notice of the meeting was given. The meeting adjourned at 5:50 p.m. During the meeting, direction was provided to administration to bring forward the following motions to public session for consideration. With respect to report LLS 1716, the recommendation is that council approve the purchase of the property described as Part 1, Plan 12R, 26557, Leamington, for the purchase price of $3,360.56 plus HST, land transfer tax, and legal fees, including the legal fees of the vendor, and that the purchase be funded from engineering count 10706208010, and further that the Director of Legal and Legislative Services be authorized to execute all documents required to complete this transaction.
Going for a mover and seconder. Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Verbeke. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? Carried.
With respect to report LLS 1916, the recommendation before Council is that Council approve the purchase of the property described as Parts 1 and 2, Plan 12R, 26281, Leamington, for the purchase price of $15,970 plus HST, land transfer tax and legal fees, including the legal fees of the vendor, and that the purchase be funded from engineering count 10761103001705000176807680, and further that the Director of Legal and Legislative Services be authorized to execute all documents required to complete the transaction.
Questions? Moved by Councillor Hammond, support by Councillor Dunn. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? And carried. Consideration of bylaws.
Bylaw 1116 being a bylaw to provide for the construction of a new bridge over the Lebo Creek Drain, 7th Concession Road Branch. Bylaw 1216 being a bylaw to provide for the construction of a new bridge over Lundy Drain. And bylaw 17-16 being a bylaw to provide for the construction of a bridge over the John Leslie Drain. These three bylaws are requiring third and final reading. And bylaw 2816 being a bylaw to amend 4-60 bylaw to appoint chief building official, building inspectors, and municipal law enforcement officers. And bylaw 2916 being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of council from its meeting held April 14th and May 2nd. Those are all three readings.
Council? Moved by Councillor Jacobs, support by Councillor Wilkinson. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? And carried. There were no notices of motion circulated, so we are open session for council and admin. Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. Some time ago, we had discussed the speed limits on the Alturia Road. It's my understanding that when the roads were first built, the 60 kilometer limit was put in as a trial period, and then at some point they were going to look at bumping it up higher. I'm wondering if it's possible for us to contact the, the ministry or the...
The county,
mm-hmm. and find out if it is possible to take a look at increasing the speed limits on the Alturia Road.
Mr. Botham.
Thank you. I guess I would like to say that the speed limit that is on that road is what was thought to be the permanent speed limit. It wasn't a trial. And the road itself is designed by all the parameters you would design a 60 kilometer an hour road. It's likely that if we wanted to increase the speed limit, we would have to modify the road, various parts of the road, to accommodate that speed. And it is a county road, so it is under the county's jurisdiction. So that's the people that we would contact.
No, I didn't get a ticket, thanks, Al.
Anything else under open session? Deputy Mayor?
Well, I thought, Mr. Mayor, we should probably acknowledge the passing of one of our retired employees due to a car accident last week. Lynn Pepper passed away last Wednesday. I went to the visitation today, and there was quite a lineup of folks paying their respect. And always came up what a friendly person she was, and she was a really good ambassador for a municipality sitting at the desk at the complex, at the recreation center. So I just wanted to mention that in passing, that in her passing, that we certainly appreciated her time with us, and we're very sorry that she met such a sad and an end before her time. She was still a fairly young person. So I just wanted to mention that if I could.
Yep. Well, thank you very much for doing that. Very much. Nothing else under open session, and we'll move to statement members non-debatable. Councillor Wilkinson.
Sure, thank you, Worship. I just wanted to invite Council and all the public. We've got a large group of
area youth from the surrounding communities too. They're participating in this weekend's production for the Little Tomato Players, their rendition of Peter Pan, which is happening out at UMEI. And it's amazing what this local youth is doing. They've been practicing real hard since February, and it's looking fantastic. Anyway, tickets are still available. This weekend it starts on Friday night, Saturday and Sunday. And yeah, if you can make it, I don't think you'd regret it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. I'd just like to state, after listening to the report from the PCC tonight and the way administration has been carrying on, obtaining funding, and from the proposals that we've been putting out, I don't think the general public really realizes how many thousands of dollars, I mean, we could even go into the millions, I guess, in some of those projects that have been secured by Peter and his staff and the directors that are out there. And I think it's a compliment to Shannon, you're sitting here, and to Rob, and to Peter as well, and the other directors, that you read in the paper where a lot of these municipalities are complaining they're not even getting any funding whatsoever, and we seem to be reaping someone's benefits, or we're reaping benefits. And I think, you know, we passed a lot of accolades, but I really believe that Peter and your staff deserve a real pat on the back for what you've been doing in this municipality. We've really been turning things around, and quite quickly, I might add. So I'd like to extend my appreciation. I'm sure the rest of council is on board with me as well, to say thank you very much for your efforts, and please continue to do them.
No other statements, Don DeBeadle, then I'll accept a motion to adjourn. Councillor Verbeke, Councillor Dunn, both ends of the table. All in favor? Carried.